Hello everyone! Welcome back to my channel, or welcome to my channel if you are new. My name is Kristen Lee, the RD, and today we're going to be talking about what to eat with a J-pouch or an ostomy. Now, last week's video, we talked about what to eat right after surgery. I can link that above. But this week, we're going to be talking about what to eat after you heal, after those first few months and your body is more adjusted to your new GI system. We are going to be going over 6 tips today on what to eat with your J-pouch or ostomy, so I hope you can take at least one of them away to help you. Tip number 1, just try it. So I'm sure you've heard this before from most of your doctors, but everyone is different. That is completely true. It's not super helpful, but in the same way it kind of is, because that means that you can try anything and everything and you don't have to feel like you're restricted with your J-pouch or ostomy. You pretty much just want to try to find your trigger foods by keeping a food diary and a diary about not only with your food but also how you felt that day and the way that your bowel movement was. So common ones that irritate people are greasy or fried foods, some acidic foods like tomato sauces or pineapple, gassy foods, and raw vegetables, especially those with skin. Tip number 2. Now this is one that has really helped me in my life with my J-pouch, because a lot of people either have trouble, it seems, with very loose stool or they're very constipated. So we want to kind of find a balance between them, and so balancing thickening and thinning foods could be really helpful for you. So if you are having more trouble with thickening foods that are like, I have a list in front of me, so I'm just going to read it off. Thickening foods are bananas, rice, applesauce or apples, toast or any kind of bread, cheese, pasta, creamy peanut butter, potatoes, cooked and canned carrots. So those foods are ones that's going to thicken your stool if you often have loose stools. Now, if you're constipated and you have too much of these foods, that could be what is making you constipated. So whenever you have those foods, you just want to pair those with a thinning food. So thinning foods for your stool are most fruit and vegetables with skin, even if you cook them, you know, such as green beans or broccoli. Those are more fibrous. They have more insoluble fiber, so it's going to pull the stool quicker through the GI system and thin it out. So other ones that thin are dried fruits, whole nuts, fried or fatty foods, spicy foods, and then high sugar foods like chocolate or other desserts. So it depends on what side you lean on. If you are a person that has more diarrhea then, or loose stools with an ostomy, then you can just pair those thinning foods with more thickening foods like the bananas and the rice. What we dietitians actually know it as is the BRAT diet, so B-R-A-T. So bananas, rice, applesauce, toast. And that's, we call it the BRAT diet. That doesn't mean that you eat that all the time if you often have diarrhea. That's just kind of like, those are the key foods to help with diarrhea that you can implement into your diet already. Okay, moving on to tip number 3. Have small portions of gas-producing foods. So everybody knows with an ostomy that your bag will fill up super full with gas, and then you might have to burp the bag, and that can be kind of annoying. So if you want to avoid that, or us with J-pouches, we have some gas pains sometimes in our stomach. So of course there's always medications that we can take for that, like Gas-X, or you know, Pepto-Bismol. But if you want to control it more through diet, you can do that too. So some gas-producing foods that you just want to have smaller portions of could be beans, broccoli, definitely carbonated drinks like pop, onions, garlic, high fiber vegetables, and then dairy. So a lot of people, when they have their colon removed, they are lactose intolerant. Not everyone, but most people are, and it will tend to produce some uncomfortable feelings of gas, or it could also cause diarrhea. So some dairy foods like milk and ice cream, those have high levels of lactose. So you want to maybe take just like a lactase supplement with them if you're going to have them. Or of course you can always switch to a no lactose version. But if that's not possible, or you know, if you just want to go out and buy a regular version of Ben & Jerry's ice cream, you can do that. Just take a couple of lactase supplements, and you can get that at pretty much any, you know, CVS store or grocery store. Otherwise, the other tip that I have for dealing with gas is taking a probiotic. So having healthy bacteria in your gut is going to help digest those gases, because if you don't have enough diverse bacteria in your gut, or you don't have just enough beneficial bacteria in general, that gas will build up and it will become really uncomfortable. The more harmful bacteria, or the non-beneficial bacteria is maybe a better word, they will produce more gas. So by taking a probiotic, you're just gonna be kind of evening out the community of your microbiome and building up some more of those beneficial bacteria to control those symptoms. Any probiotic works. You can just go and get some over-the-counter ones. It doesn't have to be a super expensive or fancy brand. You know, you might wanna, you can try like the maximum strength ones if you want, but sometimes that can produce more GI symptoms in people if they're not used to that much bacteria being there. So if you wanna start out by taking like the lower doses of probiotics, that could help until you wanna build up to the maximum strength probiotic. Tip number four, sneaking in more vegetables. I know a lot of people with J pouches say that they can't eat vegetables, period. And they just leave it at that. But that might not be necessarily true for you. You might just not have found the exact right way to cook the vegetable, or the certain vegetables that work for you. But one tip that I do have for getting in more vegetables is pureeing them, because by pureeing vegetables, you are taking out the fiber part of the vegetable. And so if you are advised to not have a lot of fiber from the vegetables for some reason, or if you just find that most fiber in general bothers you even after you cook or, you know, boil it, then pureeing could be a really good option for you. So you can put purees in virtually any food. You can put it in muffins, think like carrot muffins that can be sweet still, or you can do puree vegetables in meatloaf or soups, pasta sauces. I mean, really, you can just think of anything under the sun and you could probably put pureed vegetables in it. My other tip for adding in more vegetables to your diet, which I've already mentioned, but just like learning how to cook your vegetables in the way that works for your body is going to be so helpful in the long run. So for example, if you can't eat broccoli by just sauteing it, or by roasting it, that doesn't necessarily mean that you can't eat broccoli at all. You can just try boiling it, or you know, the other way around. Some people can't tolerate boiled potatoes, but they can tolerate it when they put it in the oven. So it just differs for everybody, and it's worth trying. Don't give up on vegetables right away. I know it can be really frustrating, but I promise you, if you keep persevering, you will be able to find some vegetables that fit into your diet. Okay, so tip number five, I mentioned this in my last video, but just in case you haven't watched it, is remembering to slow down when you are eating and remembering to chew. So the more that you chew your food while you're eating to almost a liquid consistency, is going to help with not only gas, but also preventing blockages. And when it is time for the food to come out, whether that's in an ostomy or if you have a J pouch, it's just generally going to be easier for your food to come out if there's not big chunks that you didn't remember to chew, especially with fruits and vegetables and or other fibrous foods, or like rice. Like that's really easy to just like chew a few times and then swallow it, and then you have a bunch of like big thick globs coming out. I never liked that when I had my ostomy, when I didn't chew it enough. It's almost like I could feel it coming out whenever I wouldn't chew my food well enough. And I could just feel how thick it was. And then you would have to deal with like the pancaking, and that's not fun either. So just chew as much as you can, as well as drinking a lot of water with your meals will also help thin those out and make things just like flow easier through your GI system. I also mentioned this in my last video, but I'll say it again. There are potential blockages foods or more, there's foods that have more risk for blockages. That's what I'm trying to say. And so again, that doesn't mean you can't eat them. Just remember to chew and drink a lot of water. But those potential blockaging foods are popcorn and corn, lettuce and spinach, nuts, and the skins of fruits and vegetables. So just make sure you peel them. You know, if you're having like a whole cucumber, especially if you're gonna eat it raw, make sure you peel it first. But you know, little foods, I see some people say that they can't eat things like blueberries or grape tomatoes because of those skins. But those are like, you know, those are thin skins, and there's not a lot of it. Like those are small, you know, blueberries. If you just have like a couple handfuls, it's gonna come out fine as long as you chew it well. So you don't need to like peel every individual blueberry. Don't worry about that. I know I'm saying this because maybe I'm just the only one that thinks that about like, should I peel my blueberries? But that's the one that I found was like super confusing after getting my ostomy and J pouch. It's like, there's no way I can peel every single blueberry. But no, you don't have to do that. I tried it and now I can have multiple handfuls of blueberries. I just make sure I chew them really well. Yay, tip number six, it's the last one. This is about the timing of meals. So some people ask, you know, do you guys find more success with eating small meals throughout the day or eating three big meals? And I will say to that it is different for everyone. So if you're someone that you eat like a full regular, what you used to eat, big meal for say dinner, you know, dinner is usually our largest meal of the day, even though, you know, that's controversial, but I won't get into that. But for us Americans anyway, dinner is usually the biggest meal of our day. And if you're noticing that causes a lot of uncomfortableness, then the small meals throughout the day might be more beneficial to you. So having like six small meals, you know, give or take, whatever you have time for, whatever feels right to you, that might be easier to digest. However, for other people, six small meals throughout the day might be a little too much for them. So it's kind of like if you're always having something in your system, if you're having that many meals a day, that might just like feel uncomfortable, and it's good to like empty out your stomach for you and it feels better, and then you're ready for your next big meal. And maybe that's you. And also some people say that eating small meals throughout the day will actually help prevent gas, because when you have like long periods of time without eating, gas can almost like build up and then you eat and it all kind of just wants to like come out at once, and that can feel really uncomfortable in your stomach until it does come out. So eating small meals throughout the day might be beneficial for gas as well. Like I said, it just kind of depends on you, and I encourage you to try each way because you'll never know if you don't try. Also with the timing of meals, a lot of people have trouble either emptying the bag a lot at night or just getting up to empty the pouch at night. And so I'd say if you are having that problem, to try to set a limit of what is like the earliest dinner that you can eat that feels right. So for me, I like to eat before 6 o'clock at night as my last meal. Now, if it is 8 o'clock and I'm watching a movie and I want a little snack, then I'll get a snack. It's no big deal. I don't make it like a restricting rule or anything. It's just kind of like for my own benefit. Most nights I will stop eating before 6 so that I don't feel like I have to get up multiple times throughout the night. Getting up once a night is pretty average for a J-Poucher or someone with an ostomy to empty at night. But if you are finding that it's more than that, then stopping eating at a certain point could be a good idea. All right, guys, that's all I have for you. Those are my 6 tips for eating with an ostomy or J-Pouch. There's always a ton of questions about this on the sites that I've been on, like the Facebook groups about what to eat. And so there's a ton of stuff to cover with this. So I'm sure I didn't answer everybody's question, but I encourage you to leave a comment below and I will answer anybody's question if they have more. Thanks for listening, guys. This was a lot of fun for me to do because I know how many people have questions about this and it is such a popular topic. Hit like and subscribe and I will see you on my next video. Bye, guys.